Well, good afternoon. Welcome to this concert. I'm Nathaniel Liu. I'm the artistic director of the Counterpoint Vocal Ensemble, which Robert De Cormier founded 22 years ago. I'm really, really glad that we are all here today. As I'm sure many of you know, this event was originally scheduled for January 7th, 2022, which would have been precisely the centennial of Robert's birth. He was born January 7th, 1922. Omicron had other ideas, so here we are in September. And I'd like to thank, first of all, I'd like to thank you all for being here. I'd like to thank all of the directors of the choirs who are taking part for rolling with all of the crazy changes and all of the 7,000 emails it took to put this together. I'm grateful to seeing Dawn Willis and Cheryl Blodgett and Jeff Fairbach and Oscar Scott. It's been a long time coming. This is a day to celebrate Robert's music. You're going to have memories from a lot of people who knew him well, who knew him and worked with him closer than I did. I will just say that he was an extraordinary figure in my life because, as I said shortly after he died, he became a mentor to me at a moment in my life when I thought I was done having mentors. And that's an extraordinary thing to happen to anybody. So, he meant a lot to me in a way because he entered into my life and changed me as a person. He's one of the most profound, beautiful souls I will have a chance to have met in my time here. He was also an extraordinary musician. You'll hear a lot about his soul, his just wonderful commitment to being on this planet. He was also an extraordinary musician. As a musician, I learned so much from him that I won't go into because it's technical. But he was really, really good. I'm a changed person from my time spent with him. Anyway, thank you all for being here. We would request, if you have a mask, if you're in the audience, you wear it. This is a large gathering, and there are people, you know, who are here because they desperately want to be here, but will really appreciate your masking. The choirs will mask when they're singing from there, but will come up and unmask just to hear you. Again, thank you for being here. Welcome, and enjoy.
If Robert founded the Vermont Symphony Chorus, and you'll hear about that later, he invited people from across the state to come rehearse. That meant driving from wherever you might be located to Montpelier, or to Burlington, or to Rutland. Maybe there were even one or two down in Manchester, I can't remember. But one of the reasons we picked out this piece for the Vermont Symphony Chorus is that we were off with lonesome travelers driving to all of these rehearsals. Those were beautiful, beautiful, important thoughts and all.
Oh, ourselves and others in any way we can to continue to work for peace in this sorry world and support organizations that work for peace. And I asked him to look back on parts of his life that we were particularly proud of, especially in Vermont, and he said, all this time has gone by like a flash. To have the VSO chorus and Counterpoint has been wonderful for me. It's amazing that singers travel so far from rehearsal to Newport, to Rutland, to Arlington. What are the lessons we've learned from Robert De Cormier? I think most of us spend our time trying to figure out what our purpose is in the world. Why are we part of this planet? And I have a feeling that Robert, at least since the war, since his wartime experience, had this bedrock commitment to peace. And he nurtured the power of human beings singing together for peace. He talked especially about the Terrorism Project, in the Verdi Requiem, and Domino Luis Pacem by Ray Vaughan Williams. And also he talked about the loyalty of the singers. And a lot of the carpools have offered gifts of friendship to many of us. On one late night drive from wherever we were rehearsing, somebody in our carpool said, you know, if Robert asked us to sing happy birthday to a third cousin somewhere in New Hampshire, we would drive there. We would do
close-knit. I'm Claire Hutherford. I am one of the original members of the Vermont Symphony Orchestra Chorus and a founding member of Counterpoint. And I will say, as Matt said earlier, Robert came into my life at the best possible time. I had just come back from Europe and moved back to Vermont, and I really didn't know, even though I'm a hometown girl, really didn't know what was going on in the Vermont scene. And my husband had seen in the paper an advertisement for auditions to the Vermont Symphony Orchestra Chorus. And he said, "Oh, Claire, you've got to do it." And he's regretted it ever since. Because we have traveled far and wide, and weekend after weekend, and with huge hearts and much gratitude to both Robert and Louise. They took me in, they treated me as their own. And Louise always said to me, "Don't forget your bedroom is always here waiting for you if you want to stay." And that being said, when I first met them, I'm just gonna tell a little story, not as eloquent as Linda was earlier. When I first met them, I didn't know them all that well. I knew who Robert was, I knew Louise was very sweet. But I was we were doing demo recordings for Lawson Gould publisher. And we were down here in Rutland, and I was about 8 weeks pregnant. And Louise says, "Oh, you must stay. You can't go back to St. Albans back and forth. No, you must stay." I said, "Okay, thank you very much." And so when we left at night, she said, "You go with Bob, I've got to take my car." I said, "Okay." And so he goes, "Yeah, my pickup truck's over there." Okay. So here I am, 8 months pregnant. I get in this truck with this man I don't really know. And he's driving me up into the hinterlands of Vermont. And I'm like, "Oh my God, what have I done?" But I soon realized, very, very quickly, I had nothing to dread. Robert was the most gracious, kindest, most precious soul I have ever met. He wasn't just a gentleman, he was a gentle man in every sense of the word. And as I said upon his passing, he gave so much to so many, and he asked for so little in return. All he asked was for beautiful music, and we tried to give it to him at every step of the way. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you. times as Robert's assistant in rehearsals, listening critically, making suggestions, leading warm-ups, and just coming to know so many people in that chorus. Robert, our conductor, but more so, as you've already heard, a gentle soul who befriended us. A man shaped by music, shaped by so many kinds of music across history, across the globe. A sensitive musician who had an essential impact on hundreds of us over the years, shaping us in rehearsal and on stage in performances as sensitive, expressive, well-trained choral singers, but more so to care about others and to express that care through music. One of our longtime members, one of the founding members of the chorus, Lynn Lovford, writes this: Robert always considered his choristers, wherever and whoever they were, to be his peers, musically speaking, and though we all revered him for his many accomplishments, it was always he who would thank us at every opportunity for making music with him. He treated us unfailingly as professionals and held us to a high standard, but there was never any doubting his true affection for all of us as people. Robert was always open to his singers' contributions. Of course, first and foremost, he invited us to sing with him, carefully auditioning us, and for many of us, singing collaboratively for the first time, discovering, there are other people who love to sing choral music as much as we do. Some were in Vermont, and now we've found each other. That was so special. He encouraged us to learn from one another. He would rely on people in the chorus to work on diction, and especially German pronunciation. Or he might say, Roger, what was that you heard in the tenor section? Is there something we need there to fix? And just trust us to be his ears and to help each other along in rehearsals. He was also open to other ideas that didn't necessarily have to do with singing. For the performance of Verdi's Requiem, one of the singers suggested, why don't we just keep that curtain open behind the risers at the Flint? Seeing all those pipes exposed back there gives a sense of starkness that's appropriate to the somberness of this piece. He cared for all of us in the chorus. He saw us as people in simple things, such as the way we'd make our way individually to our places on stage, not having to march up like robots to find our place in our seats. When singing Beethoven's Ninth outdoors one year, I wasn't at that particular performance, but we were standing on risers outdoors with no backing behind us. During the entire concert, as we're standing waiting to sing the final movement of Beethoven's Ninth, Robert was patrolling behind the back row of tenors and basses just to make sure no one was feeling faint and needed an assist to get down from stage. And of course, he would greet each one of us after a performance at the Flynn or at the Paramount or wherever it might be. It wasn't so much Kate Markin or others would have been conducting, but he was back there as we came off the stage to shake our hands individually and say, thank you. Thank you for singing. As we've already heard, he showed incredible care about humanity. As Lynn writes, Robert demonstrated that music is a means of communication, a means to connect humans one to another and to the things they care about. Music is a vehicle for imparting meaning to anyone and to everyone. Music is always relevant. He enriched our choral experience. Who knows when we auditioned that we would get to sing with Peter, Paul, and Mary on the stage of the Flynn. He was sensitive, too, to those in the community, inviting members of the Vermont National Guard to sit out front for a performance. And his selection of music, as we've heard, was always concerned with justice and peace. Perhaps no more so than the Terrorism Project, where we performed music and heard stories and performed the music that they performed as prisoners at the Terrorism concentration camp, bringing a sense of that suffering that we could begin to empathize with through his vision for that project. And we delighted in and learned from the many stories he told us. It wasn't so easy always as he occurred to coax those out of him, but if we prompted him, we would indeed hear a story. He was humble. Concert appearances were never about him. He encouraged us not to sing our best for him, but of course we aspire to do so, rather to sing yourself to where the music comes from. We would see what he wanted us to express in our singing, not so much from his conducting, but simply looking into his eyes. They would sparkle, they would shine, and we would sense the music that came from deep within his heart. What an honor we all feel, past and present singers in the Vermont Symphony Orchestra Chorus, to have known Robert, to have sung under his caring direction. We miss you, Robert.
Standing over at
the side waiting to be introduced at the beginning of the session. But when he began to speak about the importance of spirituals, folk songs, and songs from other cultures, his face lit up, and his tremendous passion for music was clear to see. When I moved to Vermont 12 years later, I was eager to audition for the BSO chorus and to connect with Robert. In the years that followed, I was pleased and honored to serve as his assistant conductor for the VSOC. I have many fond memories of our conversations about choral music and its power to touch the human soul. One of the most striking examples of that fact that I've ever experienced as a conductor happened in May of 2013. That spring, Bella Voce premiered the SSAA version of one of Robert's choral masterpieces. They called her Moses. A six-movement work that wove together spirituals and narration to tell the incredible story of Harriet Tubman and her role as a conductor on the Underground Railroad. We had commissioned Robert to revoice the original SATB version for women's voices, and Louise kindly agreed to serve as our narrator. We knew how deeply Robert's carefully crafted music had touched us as we rehearsed the music, but we were truly amazed by the audience's tremendous reaction to the work. The brilliant way that Robert wove together the spirituals with the narration touched us all and brought tears to the eyes of audience members and performers alike. In addition to They Called Her Moses, Bella Voce proudly commissioned Robert to compose, arrange, or revoice 10 pieces for troubled voices. Bella Voce and Solaris will continue celebrating the great choral music of Robert Cormier in our December concerts this year and in the years ahead. I was truly honored to have him as my mentor and my friend. Robert's music will continue to live and inspire all of us and future generations to strive for a world in peace.
Thank you.
I was 23 and he was 49. He was called Bob at that time and for the next 29 years, but preferred in his later years to be called Robert. Old habits are hard to break, but I do my best and I mean no disrespect. Little did I know the impact this man would have on my life, both personally and musically. We became close friends and ultimately neighbors here in Vermont. Our musical journey was long, exciting, and incredibly varied. We rehearsed, we performed, we recorded, we toured. It was all fabulous. He was an inspiring conductor, a wonderful composer, and a brilliant arranger. During one of my last conversations, we reminisced about all the wonderful musical experiences we had shared over all the years, how lucky we were, and how grateful I am. He had a deep longing for peace and harmony in our world. Appropriately, his last composition was "Give Us Peace," and we will sing that for you this afternoon. My life is richer having known, loved, and been loved by this wonderful man. I miss him so much.
Into the amazing world of Robert De Cormier in 1981 when I was hired to be his assistant conductor with the Vermont Choral Society. Forgive me. Like Nathaniel had said, I learned many, many things from Bob over the years, and I'll share one of those with you in just a moment. I was reflecting before I came up here how Bob would have loved to have been here, because Bob loved singers so, so very much. And he loved music, and he loved what singers could do with that music to reach out into the hearts of people around them. I said just a minute ago that I wish that Bob could be here, because he would have loved it. And I realized as you all started to sing, that he is here. He's right here. And he always will be. So the thing that I learned from Bob about music is love.
The next piece that we will sing all together for you is Give Us Peace. This is a piece that Robert composed for the final piece, Sing for Peace concert in Burlington. And it's also the last choral piece that he wrote. And we want to read to you the message that he wrote and that is in the printed copy for the singers. So I will read that to you. And I think it goes to all of you as well, not just the singers. Welcome to all who raise their voices and sing for peace. We join with those all over the world who yearn for peace and who struggle to bring peace into their lives. To have peace, we must end racism and inequality of the sexes and do all we can to have a more equal distribution of the enormous wealth of our country. I know that you will sing with your full hearts and find some way, however small, to carry on the struggle for peace. I am with you in spirit, and my love and my warmest, best wishes go out to you all. Give us peace.
Oh. Hello. My name is Melissa Chestnut Tangerman. And before I say what I wrote up, of course, the room is full of reminiscences, and I just wanted to bring in a memory from a rehearsal that we were having when the VSO chorus was rehearsing the Beethoven's Ninth, which the sopranos would call the Shry Fest. And we were working on a particularly, dissonant passage, and Bob, who he still was at the time, just put down his baton and he said, "You know, Beethoven was quite deaf when he wrote this." I was lucky to be geographically close to Robert and Louise, and for most Thursday evenings for 15 years, we shared car rides to Montpelier and back. Robert's gift was love of humanity, of art, of peace, through music. Witnessing hate and war, he chose love. I once read that as a life insurance actuarial class, conductors are among the longest lived. It might be that upper body exercise, but I like to think that those who devote their lives to bringing people together in service of making music also reap the benefit. In my first rehearsal with Robert, he was using a cane because he'd recently fallen off his horse and his leg was in a cast. His vitality shone through, even so, and this was 23 years before he died. He was 86 when he and Louise led Counterpoint on a fairly grueling Midwestern tour with a total of 19 concert dates in 6 states. Robert gave the world his music and conveyed the music of so many different others. He bequeaths to us his belief that the same thing in humans that can make and appreciate music would raise us above the tragedy of man's inhumanity to man. He believed with all of his immense heart that music and spirit could turn the world around. Not naively, he could be pretty caustic about those who wreak havoc in the world, and he certainly experienced evil things. But purely, sincerely, he believed. He witnessed the power of music to change, and he worked to his last days to sing for peace. So the words that we are about to sing all together lived deep in his heart. I think he would want us to leave here not only believing them, but doing our utmost not just to sing, but to be active for justice and peace.